Okay, so two things about Tyrod Taylor's name right off the bat. First of all, I do know that it's now pronounced Tyrod and not Tyrod, so I hope you guys are proud of me for actually knowing how to say one person's name. Every now and then I actually get one right and don't butcher someone's name. And the second thing being is that because I'm so used to saying Tyrod, I will without a doubt at a certain point during this video say Tyrod instead of Tyrod. It's gonna happen, so just be ready for that. And also because of my hearing, I won't notice it when editing audio. So you will hear that at some point, so just fair warning. Anyways, I could talk about my inability to say words all day, but instead let's move on to why you guys clicked on this video, and that's because Tyrod Taylor is at number 34 in my top 40 quarterback rankings. Right here at the 34 point, we're kind of getting into the situation where you either have a great backup or a bad starter, like 34 through 30, that's kind of where you're at. That's kind of Tyrod Taylor to a T, really. It's kind of the situation he's always been in, where he's either been a great backup or a good starter, and luckily for the Chargers, he's a backup right now, so he's a great backup. And hopefully he remains that way, because I don't want to see Philip Rivers ever not start a game for the Chargers. But anyways, let's start things off by talking about his strengths as a quarterback, and one of the things that he does very well is his scrambling ability. He's one of the toughest guys to bring down in terms of quarterbacks in the league. And he's also smart about how he scrambles, and I'll show you what I mean with this play. As you see, it's going to be a cover 2, and those are going to be the routes that the Browns receivers will be running. Oh, so okay, right at the bat, none of these routes are really particularly great, with the exception of maybe that crossing route, which could pick up some yards. But what you'll notice is that after this play develops, basically that gap right there in the middle of the screen could end up being wide open. There could be a great running lane if this play develops for long enough. Of course, it will take a little bit of time to develop, so obviously Taylor should try to make a throw first, but it is something that he should keep in the back of his head in case this play takes a while. And he is going to, and I know that, because this play is going to end up taking a while. Nobody's really open, however luckily for him, Cleveland did a very good job of blocking on this play, so there is basically a window right there where he could try to run through. But also as you see, there is another Steeler in this area, and he's actually cutting back to the right side of the screen, so he could potentially catch up with Taylor. But because Taylor is a fast enough guy and accelerates very quickly, he is still going to be able to run up to a top speed and pick up a decent gain. And again, that's kind of what I like in a quarterback. He wasn't looking to run, however when the opportunity presented itself, he took advantage of it. You shouldn't look to run in certain situations, however you should notice that if it is man coverage, sometimes you can run and pick up some yards, especially if you're a talented athlete like Taylor is. Like on this play, you're gonna see the Cleveland Browns send that man in motion right there, and basically if that Steeler who's lined up with him ends up following him, then it's gonna give Cleveland a pretty good idea that it could be man coverage. And he is going to follow him, because this is actually a cover 1 blitz, meaning that there's going to be 5 men rushing the passer and just 1 safety deep. Granted, Taylor doesn't know for a fact that this is going to be man coverage, people could have just switched their assignments on this one, however, he feels pretty confident that it is going to be man coverage and that a linebacker wouldn't switch assignments with defensive backs on this play. Also, once this play develops, every receiver is running deep, and look at Taylor. So it looks like he's getting ready to throw through the bottom half of the screen, but that's not what's happening at all. He has no interest in throwing, he's thinking run all the way here. His whole idea is to try to run the ball on this play. He knows every receiver is going to be running deep, so if he can try to get through, he can pick up easily at least like 5 or 7 yards, and potentially even more. So he's basically just pump faking and letting the receivers get downfield, so that way the rest of the Steelers will also get downfield. Then he's going to break up to the top half of the screen, and he's going to easily be able to run for a ton of yards, and he ends up even getting into the end zone for a touchdown. It's really just smart football from Taylor, and just to be clear, I want to explain what the difference is between looking to run and also taking advantage of a situation and running right after the ball is snapped. Because yes, Taylor at the start of that play was looking to run the ball, which I usually say don't do. Usually I say you want to look to pass first and then look to run. But Taylor wasn't necessarily looking to run first when he came into that play. It was once he realized what the coverage was, he realized pre-snap, this is going to be a great running situation. So he still did look to pass first and run second, it just so happened that he realized that running was going to be a better option before the ball was even snapped. And of course, one last good thing about having a quarterback who can run is it can also help you get out of bad situations. As you see right here, it's going to be cover 2 man, but notice I didn't show who's in charge of covering the halfback yet. Typically, it would be pretty obvious. It would be the linebacker who's lined up on that side of the halfback. That's typically who would be in charge of covering the halfback. However, Pittsburgh is actually going to do something a little bit interesting here, where they're going to have that linebacker rush the passer. Instead, they're going to have a defensive end cover the halfback, so they're definitely mixing things up on this play. The idea is basically to fool that Browns left tackle into not realizing that the linebacker is going to be rushing the passer, and it's going to work out perfectly. As you see, he has a straight shot to Taylor, so this is just, you know, an easy sack, right? Well, against most quarterbacks it would be, but against a guy who can move like Taylor, it ends up being a run for a decent gain. He rolls to the outside and picks up just a ton of yards, and even cuts back in a little bit and picks up even more yards. So that's what being a good running quarterback can kind of open up for you. It really can open up some doors for you. So I mentioned his running ability because it has to be mentioned when talking about Tyrod Taylor. But now let's get into his throwing ability, because while he gets a lot of heat for not being the best thrower, that doesn't mean that he can't make any throws. He's actually very good at making some of those short-range throws, like on this play. It's going to be a cover 2 zone and a running play action here. And what do you typically do to point of running play action against the zone coverage? Just to try to draw the linebackers in and then try to hit somebody past the linebackers. However, Cleveland actually knew what they were doing here. They kind of outsmarted the Saints in a sense. First off, after the ball is snapped, you're going to notice a couple of things. One thing, Taylor does a very good job of getting his shoulder square very early. Sometimes you want to sell the run too much, but really the best way to make sure you sell the run is just make sure you look the same on a passing play and running play every time. So that means also when you actually do hand ball off, get your shoulder square very early, so that way your opponents won't really realize whether it's going to be a running play or a passing play. But anyways, another thing you'll probably notice is that the Saints did a very good job of going back and not being fooled by the play action. Or did they? Cleveland was ready for the Saints not falling for the play action, and so they have a receiver right there who's open underneath those guys. If the Saints did fall for the play action, this actually would close up that route. But since they didn't, this now means that that receiver is open, but only for a short period of time. So Taylor has to quickly read if the linebackers got fooled by the play action or not, and then make a throw very quickly, and he does both of those things and able to pick up a small but decent gain. Again, worth mentioning, this play will not be making any highlight reels anytime soon. However, you know, you can't go broke making a profit. I say it and it's cliche, but it is true. Sometimes you just gotta move the ball 4 yards down the field, and when you need to move the ball 4 yards down the field, oftentimes Tyrod Taylor is your guy. Well, of course Taylor's best known for his short range passes and his running ability, this guy can throw the ball deep pretty well. I actually would think more than anything, he needs to work on his deep ball confidence, because when he does decide to sling it, every now and then he can make some really pretty throws, and this one would be an example of that. One thing you'll probably notice right at the bat is look at all the Saints players on the line right now. They're basically trying to sell as though it's gonna be man coverage. Because you typically don't blitz on zone, you can, but typically you won't. Typically you will blitz and have man coverage. And also, if only one player who's deep, this is appearing as though it could just be like a cover one hole or a cover one linebacker blitz. However, it's instead a disguise, and it's instead going to be a cover two zone here. And that's important because look at the two routes that those two Cleveland Browns on the top half of the screen will be running. This is basically the kind of route concept you'll run to try to beat a cover one, actually. Because of course, if there's only one safety in the middle of the screen, he would have to cover that receiver who's running to the middle of the screen, and then the plus receiver could get open downfield. And since that's not going to happen, well then this play should be a complete disaster, correct? Well, yeah. I mean, you look after the ball is snapped, and I mean, look at how much room that Saints player has on the Browns player. Now, I noticed the video giving credit to Tyrod Taylor. I almost said Tyrod there, but I didn't. Are you proud of me? Anyways, moving on. Alright, I knew it was going to happen eventually. I really didn't mean to do that. I noticed the video giving credit to Tyrod Taylor. I'm just going to keep calling him Taylor. I'm just going to say Taylor. I'll only say Taylor. Don't even worry about his first name. But I actually think he might have made the wrong read on this one, because that's the guy who he's trying to throw it to, and clearly he's not open at this point. If you notice his cover too, then you would not make this throw, because that Saints player could easily get back and make a play. It's possible that's the case, or maybe Taylor just trusts his guy, but either way, he's going to take a deep shot. It's a dangerous play unless his receiver is able to gain enough ground, and it's a perfect throw, but both of those things are going to happen. Again, you have to give credit to the Browns receiver, along with giving some blame to that Saints safety who was deep, but Taylor made a perfect throw on that one. This guy can have a good deep ball from time to time, and that one was just absolutely perfect. I mean, he was at his own 45-yard line, and he threw it to the very edge of the end zone with perfect accuracy. I mean, that one will be on his career highlight reel. That's just an incredible throw. So again, this guy has a deep ball. Maybe not the best one in the league, but every now and then he can throw one up there and it can get caught for a big gain. So I've already talked about Taylor's scrambling ability, how he can make short passes, how he can make deep passes, but what else can he do? Well, one thing is a play like this. If we take a look, it is going to be a cover 2 zone, but with an extra dolphin dropping back into coverage, so it's going to be 8 men in coverage on this one. Those are going to be the routes that the Bills receivers will be running, and that one route in particular is the one that's probably going to get the most open. But of course, it's not going to get quite as open as you would hope, because there is an extra man dropping back into coverage, so all of the gaps in coverage have now shrunk. So as you see, it's going to take a long time for someone to get open. It's going to take a really long time for someone to get open, but finally, there is a receiver open. However, at this point, all hell is broken loose behind the line. Taylor has to scramble out just because it took too long for someone to get open, even though there was only a 3-man rush. However, personally, I just am not a fan of only having a 3-man rush against a mobile quarterback, and you're going to see why. Taylor's able to run out, gain some time, and then make a great throw on the run, and they're able to pick up a decent gain. And maybe I should also explain the stakes in this game. This is actually week 17 2 years ago when they needed to win this game to make the playoffs. We all remember the crazy Andy Dalton fourth down touchdown play that actually got them into the playoffs. However, they needed to win this game for that situation to even happen. Otherwise, it actually would have been the Chargers making the playoffs that year. So this was a must-win game for them, and Taylor played very well, and they were able to pick up that win. That's something I have talked about in a number of these videos, is how good can you play with the stakes on the line, and Taylor played very well in that Week 17. One thing I probably should mention about Taylor is he can struggle in the accuracy department from time to time. Not in the sense that Blake Bortles will, where he'll just make a throw and you'll say, how in the world did you miss that one that badly? But more so, like, he'll miss a throw basically 6 inches away from when he was trying to hit it. And I know it doesn't seem like that much, but honestly, when these windows are so tight in the NFL, sometimes 6 inches is all it takes. Like on this play, for example, it's going to be a cover three zone, and they're going to have a receiver basically run past those linebackers right over there. So one thing you're going to see right off the bat is that while he does have that receiver open, and there is a gap right there, there's two linebackers on either side of him. So he's going to have to make his throw, and he ends up throwing a bit behind that receiver, who still, in fairness, did make the catch. And I know some people will be saying, well, he had to make sure he fit it in between those two linebackers right there, but he really didn't. He could have just thrown it a little bit earlier, and it would have been a much bigger gap. I don't believe that he was trying to fit it just perfectly in between those two linebackers, because I think there was enough space. I think he just missed the throw a little bit, but that's okay. I would consider that play a bad play, but I wouldn't consider it a horrendous play by any means. But again, I know people are probably shouting at their computers or at their phones when watching this video, what are you talking about Tyrod Taylor showing up in a big moment? In his one playoff game, they put up 3 points. Clearly this guy does not show up in the big moments. And I personally think that's totally fair, because he had two big games. He played really well in one of them and then played really poorly in the other one. So I personally wouldn't say that that's totally fair. However, it is a little bit fair. I mean, he didn't play well in that Jaguars game. One of his biggest problems in that game, and honestly probably his biggest problem just as a player as a whole, is something like this. It's going to be a cover two zone, and take a look at what happens right after the receivers run their routes. As you see right now, they have a receiver wide open down there in the bottom half of the screen, so Taylor should try to hit him, and it could easily pick up a first down. That's just a no-brainer decision. But Taylor sees a guy who's kind of open and is going to try to throw it there anyways, and it ends up getting batted up and then intercepted. Really, it's his field vision that isn't terrible, but it definitely could use some work. That's probably what I would say is his biggest weakness, is making reads as a quarterback. He definitely struggles in that regard from time to time. And again, he can make some good reads too, as you saw with his scrambling ability earlier. Not to mention the throw was kind of a duck. It definitely could have been thrown a little bit harder. But again, that's a tough play, because if you throw it too hard, now it's a tough catch. And again, I'm not saying he's a dumb guy by any means, but definitely his inability to make reads consistently is probably why he's only at number 34 on this list. I would love to put him higher, and honestly, I kind of wish that he was starting next year, because he is such a fun quarterback to watch, but I can't justify putting him ahead of any of these other guys. But hey, that's just my opinion. I've now made 7 of these videos, so what do you think about it so far? Do you think I'm doing a pretty good job with this list, or am I doing a terrible job? Let me know in the comments below, and I'm sure all of you guys will be positive and no one will have a single negative thing to say, because that's how the internet works. But in all seriousness, I do appreciate all feedback, negative or positive, and thanks a lot for watching.